Hello to all viewers who are watching today's CME. Welcome you all. And also, without wasting any more time, let me just tell you in few words. We will be having an awesome CME today. As usual, we had on previous. You may go and check it out also on our channel. And on beginning, I would like to say that please make sure to subscribe for more contents like this. And we will meet you at the very end. So for now, let's start our today's session.
Should I start, Orko?
Yes, ma'am, you can.
Good evening, everyone. My regards to all my teachers and seniors, with special mention to Dr. Kolani sir, our director and ex-director, my seniors, Dr. Bidut Mukherjee and Dr. Pralay Sharma, with whose hard work and efficiency we have reached to this 12th episode of online CME session today. Myself, Dr. Pragya Paramita Chatterjee of 6th Batch BHMS, welcome you all on behalf of NIH Alumni Association to today's topic, a homeopathic journey through cases and strategic use of IT for homeopaths. Today, we are proud to have with us my senior, Dr. Ashish Basu, as our moderator. Dr. Ashish Basu is an assistant professor to the Department of Case Taking and Repertory at NCC Homeopathic Medical College and Hospital, Howrah. We welcome you, sir. We are proud and privileged to have with us our speakers to today's topic. Firstly, Dr. Savant Ranjan, AMO, Ayush Government of Bihar. We welcome you, sir. We also have with us Dr. Shuman Handler, lecturer, Department of Community Medicine at PCN Homeopathic Medical College and Hospital, Kolkata. We welcome you, sir. Now, we are eagerly waiting for a successful session ahead. So, without wasting any more time, may I hand over my charge to Orko, our backstage coordinator. Orko Mukherjee, thank you for rendering such a wonderful service to keep this session ongoing. Thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am. And so it's now time to bring up on screen our today's host, Dr. Vidyut Mukherjee and Dr. Debnarayan Kolani, sir. Over to you all. Kalyani sir, you can start as Vidu sir is facing some problem, I guess.
Thank you everybody, especially Pragya Paramita, Dr. Ashish Basu, Swant Ranjan and Suman Haldar. I think we'll enjoy a very beautiful session on the new subject. Rather, homeopathy is going to be instrumentized, adapting with modern equipments, and it will cut our time, energy, and expand our knowledges within a very short period that we will learn from the brilliant speakers of alumni. Thank you very much. Let us start. Let first speaker, our beloved Dr. Swant Ranjan, AMO Ayush Bihar, alumni of NIH, please be on the stage and start your session.
Sir, before that, can we bring Ashish Basu, sir, to conduct the moderator session?
Just bring him, bring him to conduct the program.
Okay. Okay, so I'm bringing Ashish Basu, sir, then. Ashish Basu, sir, on you.
Yeah. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir. With my respect to you. And with my respect to all my teachers of NIH, the seniors. And with the best and good wishes of Diwali to everyone, let's start our today's program. The topics have been very wonderfully selected by Sir you and Dr. Mithun Mukherjee about the strategic use of IT for homeopaths. This is a very important topic as it has not been discussed previously. And Shumon is very, I know Shumon will be very wonderfully discussing this because he is well equipped with the IT sector. And this at present is very is a very necessary topic because we are using the wave, we are using the softwares very well, especially in the repertory sector, as I am assuming that. So the young homeopaths and also the older ones like us and even the others, they need to understand the use of IT very well so that they can upgrade themselves. And we shall eagerly wait for Shumon to discuss regarding all the things that we should know to improve ourselves strategically regarding IT, use of IT for the homeopaths. And also from someone, I am really eagerly waiting for him to discuss some wonderful cases, as has been treated by himself as AMO and also in his personal clinic. We shall all be waiting eagerly to hear all the miracles, the good cases done by him. Yes, now. First, I think I should ask Dr. Sawant Rajan to come up on the dais and start his presentation. Dr. Sawant Rajan, please.
Thank you so much, Dada. A very good evening to Kalyani sir, Dr. Pralay Sharma sir, and my respected seniors, batchmate and juniors. Let's start the today's session. A homeopathic journey through cases. Ayamo yasya bhutanam jayate ena shubrata tadeva hamyam drabyam na.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. Please click on the hide option, sir, in order to get a full view of your program PPT, sir. Click on the hide option just right beside your stop sharing one. Yes.
Okay.
Now you can turn on the slideshow and continue, sir.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
It's okay now.
Ayamo yasya bhutanam jayate yena subrata tadeva hamyam drabyana punati chikitsitadam. When a substance in its gross form produces an ailment, doesn't its refined form produce relief of the same ailment? This is a sloka from the Srimad Bhagavat Mahapuran. Actually, this sloka came into existence by the Hanuman himself, who realized this and gives us such a beautiful system of medicine, homeopathy. According to him, homeopathy, a very simple system of medicine, mission is to cure by restoration of the sick to health. The way to restore the health should be shortest, reliable, and harmless. We have a three-dimensional approach: knowledge of disease indication, knowledge of medicinal power, choice of remedy. Medicine indicated. This is the key of homeopathy. So let's start our journey with case one. Mr. Kumar is at about 42 years, a resident of Ara, Bihar. Suddenly he feels he can't urinate. Treated by some local doctor for a day, doesn't respond. Then treated by urologist, who gives 2 units of RL and diuretic, but ultimately edema develops. He has given 2 units of RL, probably with the idea that when RL is given, the blood volume will be more, so kidney has to filter. But it doesn't occur, so anasarca developed. gradually shifted to Ruben Hospital, Patna. Here he was diagnosed as a case of ARF, acute renal failure. This is the very initial report. You can say urea is 405 and creatinine is 6.1. After dialysis, the creatinine and urea fall a bit. Urea came to 183 and creatinine fall to 4.1. He came under homeopathic treatment thereafter. Mr. Kumar had an abscess treated with homeopathic medicines. Gluteal abscess subsided, and a few days afterward, the episode of ARF occurred. Thirst and appetite diminished. So the choice of remedy was Epismel, but no change in urine output after Epis. The case was evaluated once again, but still I thought it's Epis. So when indicated medicine doesn't work, there must be some obstacle to cure. So most of the abscesses are staphylococcal in origin. So I had given staphylococcine 1M as a block remover. Thereafter, Epismel in LM potency 01 to 06 was given. Urea came down to 195 and creatinine to 2.3. This is the report. Thereafter, I thought it's not very good to waste the time with LM. So again, switch over to the centesimal potency and give some higher one. Because it's an acute case, so higher potency give good result. So APs 200, 1M and 10M, one dose on three successive days was given. And this is the result before you. The blood urea only 37 and creatinine 1.4. So we can say health is restored. This is the first case. Now came to second case. A female patient, K. Devi, about 80 years, was diagnosed as a case of CKD, chronic kidney disease, when she develops bipedal edema. On investigation, creatinine was 2.5. She has bloated lower abdomen, passage flutters, desire sweets, become tearful when someone says thank to her. So was given Lycopodium 01 to 09. Actually, the last one, become tearful when someone say thank to her. During case checking conversation, I told, you are such a nice lady. She told, no, I am not nice. No one told me like that. You know, you are mother, you are such and such in your family, but you are saying, no, I am not nice. So she told, she just told, oh, sir, yes, I am, but no one told me like that. And by just saying these two words, no one told me like that, Ganga, Jamuna, dono aankhon se beh chale. So the confirmation of Lycopodium, and it was given, and just see the result. Creatinine came to 1.5 only. Case 3, Mr. Dubey, a male patient about 60 years, had high creatinine borderline, along with grade 2 proteinuria and epithelial cast in urine. This is the report. Creatinine is 1.59 and urea 43. Both are just raised across the border. Mr. Dubey expresses himself in very few words. So towards introvert, skin shiny, greasy, pain in the left ankle and knee, coating on tongue, nails have thick ridges, warts on neck, and these are onion raw. Actually, when I talk about his food habits, he told usko khane mein salad chahiye aur salad mein aadha pyaaz chahiye. So I took the desired raw onion, and definitely the medicine was arborvitae thuja. Arborvitae, actually word used many times by Somen Adhikari sir, so I have kept that, and it was given in again LM 1 to 40 successively, and just see the result. Creatinine fall down to 1.3. Now came to case 4. A male patient, Mr. Yadav, 60 year, had acute myocardial infarction along with renal failure and uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. was first tackled at Away Institute of Medical Sciences, Gaya. A pacemaker was placed and referred to Paras Hospital, Patna for further management. There he was labeled as grade 4 renal disease and dialysis was advised. This is the discharge summary. Acute inferior wall, MI, hyperkalemia, diabetes, etc., etc. This is the report. Urea 125, creatinine 3.9 and uric acid 12.2. The same thing. He was unable to move due to high grade pain in the joints and low hemoglobin, with intensified pain in the finger joints, widely opened eyes. Dr. Ellen Khan sir invariably told whenever patient present with you a widely opened eyes with other indication, definitely thyroidinum can be given. This is a objective symptom of thyroidinum. So I had given in single dose. Few days after, he develops very offensive urine. So definitely high uric acid and very offensive urine, benzoic acid was given. 5 drops TDS, gradually joint pain reduced and he can walk with support. Previously he was bedridden. And he was given blood transfusion, almost a unit blood every week, along with erythropoietin injection. In spite of that, his hemoglobin falls. So lots of lysis of RBC, more production of uric acid, and definitely the joint pain get on aggravated. So I had given him Vipera 200. After Vipera, hemoglobin level remains sustained. No more blood transfusion is needed. Then they visited CMC Vellore. There he was diagnosed as CKD stage 2. Now question is, why Vipera? Viper, a poison, a hemolytic poison. It means it breaks the RBC. When you observe a patient undergoing Vipera poisoning, he develops rapidly jaundice. So jaundice is due to the breakage of RBC. So due to destruction, more uric acid is also produced. So joint pain get worse. And indication of Vipera was pain ameliorated by elevating limbs up. He lies down in bed but keeps his legs up. And this I saw in a picture sent by the patient party. So I inquired ki ye pair upar kyun rakhte hain, any paata upre tule kyun na rakhen. So he told he get amelioration from that. So considering the pathological background along with the indication, Vipera was given and it brings the cure. You can see the creatinine 1.79. Here the urea is 105. In next few reports, it has came down to 40. It's not available here actually. So the message is, sometimes to bring the cure, a series of medicines are needed. In this case, thyroidinum, benzoic acid, Vipera leads to restoration of the health. Came to next case, a case of diastolic dysfunction, a kind of heart failure. Heart failure means a condition when the heart cannot provide sufficient blood to meet physiological needs of the body. There are so many types of heart failure. Our issue is diastolic heart failure, number 6. It is a condition in which the ventricle fails to relax properly. In diastolic heart failure, since the ventricles fails to relax normally, leading to incomplete filling of the chambers. So, less amount of blood is pumped out to the body. A case, D. Devi, 40 years. In her past history, she has a very severe pain in the knee joint, and that time it was treated by calcireotide. In April 2007, patient presented before me with BP 140 by 100, chest pain aggravation on thinking, severe anxiety, severe palpitation on exertion, bilateral pedal edema, cracked painful soles and bleeding too, recurrent aphthous, profuse perspiration, constipation, desire sweet egg and dream of dead people. The echocardiography shows grade 1 diastolic dysfunction. This is a cracked and bleeding sole. And this slide shows the pitting edema over the limb, lower limb. This is the echo report. You can see grade 1 diastolic dysfunction, normal systolic function. This is the ECG of the patient, almost normal. The patient was prescribed calcarea ARS. The key indication was aggravation on thinking. After 15 days, calcarea ARS 02 and 03 was given. With 01 and 02, there was no result at all. But I stick to the medicine. No, this is the medicine. You have to continue. And after 03, the patient started improving. Palpitation decreased. Chest pain better than before. Pedal edema subsided slowly. BP also fell down to 120 by 90. Pain in joint start to decrease. Pain in cracked soles decreased. Bleeding arrested. Palpitation decreased. Aphthae better. So gradually calcarea ARS 0, 11 and 12, etc. were given. This is the picture. You can say a bit healed, but cracks are still there, but bleeding is not there. In this slide, you can see the edema is not there. The superficial veins are vanished. When edema develops in the lower limb, first the superficial veins get vanished. Thereafter, the accumulation further increases, then edema goes on. So when veins are visible, no one can say it's edema is there. BP 120 by 82, pedal edema vanished, pain in the knee joint better, no chest pain, patient as a whole much better. Next case, case 6, a case of epilepsy. A 12-year child was normal at birth, past history has a fall over the head 2 years ago. Symptoms sensitive to cold, food, drinks, frequent coryza cough, etc. Fever, febrile convulsion. This is the patient's picture. Following symptoms were present. Aura, it was not very prominent, but he has developed sometimes attack after hyperpyrexia, sometimes after irritability and anger on little things. Tonic phase was there, body become stiff. Epileptic cry was also there. Clonic phase, short jerky movement, and sometimes he passed a stool, locked jaw. Placid coma and sleep. He remains unconscious for 5 to 10 minutes, after which he had a deep sleep. In 2012, some homeopath has prescribed him Natrumsulf 200 few doses. Sensitivity to cold become less. Frequency of attack become a bit less. This was the history portion. It's not my treatment. The patient party consulted me in December 2007. For an event, he got very angry and violent, started beating everyone in the house, and sometimes he used to roam naked here and there in house and use slang languages. Then the patient party called, "Sir, aisa aisa hai, kya karna hai?" I told, "Give him Stramonium 200. After which, he became calm and slept. Thereafter, the patient came to clinic, so I had just continued Stramonium 0x1 in LM. Gradually to 0x6 improved. In June 18, the patient came with a complaint of recurrent abscess. So recurrent abscess usually sephritic. Cephalinum 1M was given. It was the month of June. So aggravation in the mid-summer, usually sephritic affection. And till now, he didn't get any epileptic attack. Stramonium further continued. This is the prescription. You can see cephalinum 1M, then Stramonium 7, thereafter again Stramonium 0x8, etc. In October 18, he develops tinea corporis, and where this was itching, aggravated at night, his tongue was moist, very thirsty, discharge from the ringworm was watery. So I had given again a syphilitic medicine, Merxol 200, few doses, and Stramonium still continued, 013, 14. After this, his ringworms was cured. Also, his energy level got better. Anger become less. By January 29, he was on Stramonium 15, but currently he is on Stramonium 26. This is prescription of the same MRADSD plus seizure. The patient was continually improving. The child become less moody, anger decreased, and the last attack of epilepsy in December 17. Thereafter, no attack noticed. And surprisingly, the patient start to learn something now. Next case, case 7, evidence-based homeopathy on vocal cord paralysis. This is the picture of vocal cord. Everyone knows. Vocal cord paralysis, inability of movement in one or both the vocal folds, maybe due to damage of vagus or nerve going to vocal cord or due to damage in brain. Here a case, 80 years old patient, he developed deglutition of solid or liquid impossible. Na to unko solid khana kha pa rahe the, na liquid kha pa rahe. Jo bhi kha rahe the, vomit kar de rahe the. So the case remained in puzzle for so long time. Treated by some local doctor in Gramin area. He has given some antacid, etc., etc., not responded. Again came to some physician, he has investigated liver, he has investigated renal, nothing is there. Goes to ENT. ENT person was also not able to recognize this, the patient is developing vocal cord paralysis. This is the most puzzling thing. Then he came to me for consultation. Aap kuch homeopathy de dijiye, bas ulti hai. So I am just seeing the patient is sinking. क्या हुआ ऐसा उल्टी कौन सा है जो ठीक ही नहीं हो रहा आपका तो आई हैव जस्ट केम इन अ केस डॉक्टर डी बासु सर हैज टोल्ड अस द वॉमिटिंग कॉजेस ऑफ वॉमिटिंग इन द प्रोबेबली 9th और 10th पाथ ही हैज रिटन द वोकल कॉर्ड पैरालिसिस द वर्ड ऑफ दैट स्लाइड केम इनटू फ्लैश इन माइंड आई थॉट इट्स डेफिनेटली केस ऑफ वोकल कॉर्ड पैरालिसिस देन आई स्टार्ट टू इमेजिन हिज साउंड मतलब बोल कर दिखाइए ही वॉज नॉट एबल टू स्पीक प्रॉपर Then I confirm it might be a case of vocal cord paralysis. So I told, please send him to higher hospital. Thereafter, consult me. So the endoscopy was done at the Udyan Hospital, Patna, and vocal cord paralysis. Vocal cord palsy is written here, a low grade paralysis probably, and ischemic insult in the brain also there. This is the video. When he was admitted to the hospital, just you can see Ryle's tube is there.
Sir, does your video contain any audio?
Patient was admitted. So, case, when he was discharged from the hospital, history of a small abscess in the right ear, treated by allopathy, he develops vomiting thereafter. So, I had considered right-sided and history of suppressed eruption. So, definitely causticum came into role. One name was given. Thereafter, the voice become a bit clear, nasal intonation, can walk. With mild pedal edema, rise to feeding continued. Thereafter, voice becomes still a bit clear, but nasal intonation of voice is there. He can swallow saliva. And when the patient party told he can swallow saliva, this gives me an immense pleasure. If he can swallow the saliva, then the food and drink can also be swallowed. So I advise to please give a sip of water, a spoon of water only, not much. In meanwhile, I had advised him to give fruit juices and he developed LRTI after taking the fruit juice. So I had considered it as a hydrogenoid constitution with Lewis expectoration. So natrum salt 200 was given few doses. Thereafter, LRTI was cured and finally Ryle's tube was omitted. Patient started to take food and drink, voice returned a bit husky and low tone. This video contains sound.
Then, sir, I think there is some problem. Yeah, sir, just escape once and come to the Chrome tab, sir. I think there is some share screen type problem, sir. Just escape once and come to the Chrome part.
Okay.
And redo the share screen option, sir, once again. I told you to click on the share audio button, which you will see on the left-hand side while sharing.
Yeah, I had clicked over that.
I think there is some problem with your audio. Just redo once it again. Once again, sir, just click on stop sharing, sir.
Okay, stop screen.
Yes. Just redo redo the same thing again, sir. By
share screen.
Same way. Click share on the share screen.
Share screen. Again, share screen.
Again, share screen.
Yes. Then the entire screen option will pop up. Click on that,
okay.
The replica, and okay. On very bottom you will share audio. Share audio it will be there. Just click on the box. Click on tick mark that.
Okay, tick that.
Have you done, sir?
Okay, tick that.
Yes, sir.
Then share it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then got it.
Now you turn on your.
Then got it.
Now you can turn on your. Yes, sir.
Should I click
now you
got
can
it?
Turn on your PPT.
Should I click got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Now turn on your PPT and just go on with the same slide which we have left from. Click on
okay.
The slideshow.
Okay.
Yes. Over to you now, sir.
Sir,
make sure to click on the hide option.
Okay, hide.
Yes. Okay,
hide.
Sir.
Okay, so please see, watch the video.
ग्राम बढ़ के चकिया से बोल रहे हैं गला में पोलिया मार दिया था वो भी अब धीरे धीरे ठीक है खा रहे हैं दूध पी रहे हैं घूम रहे हैं सब तरह से अच्छे और हमारा कोई तरह की दिक्कत नहीं गला थोड़ा गेट पर है कोई जिकदारी है न तो और कोई जिकदारी नहीं
तो You can see a very husky voice. The patient has improved. But when we given him feed, a new problem came. Cough violating. When he used to take meal, a few bolus goes inside. Thereafter develops a very severe cough, very annoying cough, and he has to left the meal. So again, patient party become panic. Ki pata nahi doctor sahab dawa de to rahe hain, theek to ho raha tha, pata nahi fir se paralysis ho gaya kya. तो मैंने बोला जस्ट वेट कफ फिटिंग वाइल दिस इज द रूब्रिक एक्चुअली एलिमिनेटिंग रूब्रिक आई हैड टेकन फ्रॉम द मर्फी एंड देयर लॉट्स ऑफ ड्रग आर देयर इन द थर्ड ग्रेड कोनियम इज देयर सो कंसिडरिंग द ओल्ड एज इफेक्ट ऑफ पैरालिसिस एंड द सिम्टम कोनियम वाज गिवन Conium max 01 to 012 was given. Now patient is enjoying a very healthy life. A next video will show you he can eat.
Video ban raha jab khansi aavega na. Waisa hi banate raho. Theek hai. Waisa hi banate raho 10 minute pura kha lenge. Kya ye karna.
Liye taraf chale. Kahan sa baat ho gaya.
देखो दादा का वीडियो बन रहा है ऐसा ही बनाना आओ आराम से धीरे खाना यही में तो एक बार कर देता है उल्टी या कुछ भी पहले उस पूरा अंदर कर लीजिए उसके बाद फिर मुंह में लीजिए आराम से धीरे धीरे खाइए रुक जाइए उसी में कभी कभी फंस जाता है तो खांसी आ जाती है जबरदस्त रेगुलर इतना खाने का क्या मतलब है मतलब कहीं जाना तो है नहीं एकदम आराम से लीजिए ये रुक जाइए खाने का तरीका वही है चबाइए उसको खूब एकदम महीन कीजिए उसके बाद फिर ऊपर लीजिए
Vă rog, mă dăm dana.
Ha.
De fine bărbat eu vreau să mă pun mamă.
So patient has finished the meal so nicely, and this is the evidence the vocal cord paralysis is over. Came to next case, a case of deaf mutism. Actually, deafness is broadly defined in two categories. Deafness because deafness leads to muteness of voice, or patient is mute because of something else. In this case, patient cannot listen properly, so she cannot speak. A 3-year child can speak only bisyllable sound, only few words, and that's very also not clear. Full term delivery delivered by LUCS, lower uterine caesarean section in hospital. Birth weight was 2.5 kg. She was evaluated at AIIMS Patna and diagnosed as a outer hair cell dysfunction. Right ear and left ear, it's very clearly written here, not responding to sound. You can see the babes in one ear, a very little variation, and in another ear, a very flat babe. And right ear, moderate to moderately severe hearing loss, and left ear, severe to profound hearing loss. The same thing, child, when the case was evaluated, child is lachrymose mostly, anger veins, she cannot express herself, a neurological affection, intrauterine history of typhoid, she likes salty food mostly. Mother had suicidal thoughts during pregnancy, and she has an attempt of suicide even during pregnancy. So considering all these things, suicidal lachrymose like aurum, desire salty food like natrum. So following Dr. Kent, I had made a synthetic prescription, aurum mur natronatum, and given in LM potency. Started from 01, the slides of 07, 08, etc. And she start learning new words like sher, bagh, handa, jhanda, jai mata di, mossi, otti, copy, etc., etc. AMN 01 to 07 was given with slight improvement in vocabulary. Start to learn new words gradually, but after 08 to 09, no such improvement came. Then again, I thought some block remover should I should give. Then I had considered the intrauterine history of typhoid and given typhoid in a 1M. Thereafter, 010 was given. And she start to say small sentences. Again, her facial distortion was also there while talking. She has to exert herself while talking. So it also start to decrease, become cheerful, and a bit activity increased. She has knocked the door of a school first time. And this thing shared by her mother with very tearful expression. In this case, Bera test was repeated, but does not show much improvement, but clinically child is improved. This is the second Bera test. It shows moderate hearing loss, right ear. But in previously, it was moderate to moderately severe hearing loss. So a bit in improvement. The improvement is shown in this video. She respond to sound.
Bolo khargosh.
और मामू
भाभी है, मैंना बाबू है, भाभी है लक्ष्मी
बिच्छी। हाँ अच्छा, और मामू मौसी, मौसी का मौसी हरपान, मौसी बोलो, मौसी बोलो, मौसी।
सो सी इज रेस्पॉन्डिंग एट लीस्ट टू द साउंड। केम टू नेक्स्ट केस, दिस इज द केस ऑफ दिस वेरी लॉकडाउन इन probably March. Mr. Kumar, 14 year, fall down from the roof, get trauma to head, become unconscious, treated by allopathic doctor, neurologist, remain unconscious. A report of CT scan, it shows intraventricular hemorrhage in the left lateral ventricles, focal hemorrhagic constitution, left basal ganglia and left basal frontal lobe, etc. affected. This is a video of the patient. An unconscious patient. Rise tube and oxygen both are going on side by side from almost 10 to 12 days. So coma, he had fever. Fever subsided before my visit. Had vidal test positive, tafad, along with raised liver enzyme, SGPT, SGOT are raised. Unstable heart rate. Sometimes the cardiac monitor shows heart is beating 56, 70, 46, 40 not, minimum was 56 and maximum was 110. So unstable heart, probably the terminal stage. He was on oxygen therapy with a very rigid body, hypertonic. Typhoid was a key for the lock for me. I start to think typhoid remedies, baptisia, stool, urine. So baptisia is ruled out, and baptisia also not cover the variable heart rate. Next is veratrum viridi. High temperature it covers, variable pulse it covers, but it does not cover coma. In repertory it is there in the grade 3 for coma, but in this case coma is the main issue. So I had also discarded this. Next is phosphoric acid, a remedy for typhoid. It covers variable pulse, it covers coma, and the basic element of this acid is phosphorus. A very good liver remedy. The immediate indication was lies like a log. Log means a huge trunk of tree. So wherever you keep that, it remains like that. So patient is in coma like that over the bed. And logs are very rigid. The patient is also very rigid. Hypertonicity is there. So phosphoric acid 200 was given with very frequent repetition. I think it was repeated 4 or 5 times per day for first day. And next day, this is the video. Patient become conscious.
दाते से।
हाँ ठीक है।
बढ़िया से कस के दांत से दबाओ खींचो। सर रखा जाएगा प्लास्टिक साइड पे। हेलो कोशिश करो एकदम फटेगा। हाँ फाड़ो अभी 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 एकदम फटेगा दांत से।
The conscious patient, and this is the cardiac monitor after phosphoric acid. Just see over the oxygen saturation, oxygen was omitted, and just look the heart rate. Patient become conscious, heart rate gradually become 90 plus minus 5, and rigidity become less. And the most pleasant thing, patient return to home. A hopeless case, patient become conscious. This is the grace of homeopathy. So being a student of homeopathy, my aim is to learn about medicine if indicated. Dhanyavad, but still I have few slides to show. Please give me 2 minutes. I had a proposal of research in homeopathy through my alumni association to the current director. Every homeopathic dilution have nanoparticle of original substance. Probably the size of nanoparticle reduces with increase in potency. 30 has larger size than 200 and so on. Field of research is measurement of size of nanoparticle in its potency. If we had a size of nanoparticle, then that could lead to a standardization of homeopathic drug. We can say this size of phosphorus is there, so it should be 30, it should be 200, 1 m, 10 m, like. Next, trituration and succussion are the ways to produce nanoparticle in Master Hahnemann's era. Nowadays, nano milling is going on. We can get the desired size of nanoparticle. So now field of research is whether phosphorus 30 prepared conventionally by our method, homeopathic method, and alcoholic solution of nano milled phosphorus 30 are the same or not. If the result be same, then just imagine such an industrial issue can be solved. Cost, time, manpower, everything can be saved. And my request to the Honorable Director, sir, to please do needful, could be a milestone in the history of homeopathy. Thank you so much. Dhanyavad.
Many, many thanks, Rajan. From a very long period, I am inspiring all the alumni and NIH students.
It's a nice session. Savan, thank you, Savan, for such a wonderful presentation. And we had learned a lot. Getting your proposal, she will go to it. Kalyani, please keep a note. We'll discuss at the end of the program. Before that, I'll request Orko to bring our moderator Ashish to the screen so that Ashish can give his over to Ashish.
Yes, Savan, it was a wonderful presentation we heard from you. It was really inspiring. You had presented about 10 cases. All the cases were excellent, and your presentation was also accident. It was very informative. And I have a few questions, but I shall not ask you now. Let us complete the session because Dr. Haldar is also waiting in the queue. So we are waiting all for hearing Dr. Haldar also. But all your cases, I repeat, were very, very, very promising. They were very interesting also. But I have a few questions which I have noted down. I shall ask you at the end of the session. Now I would request Dr. Bidul Mukherjee to please bring on Dr. Shumon Haldar so that we can start the next session. Dr. Shumon Haldar, please.
Good evening, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, Shumon.
Shubho Deepavali, happy Diwali to you all. Respected my professors, seniors, and lot of love to my colleagues and beloved juniors. It is my honor and privilege to present on this esteemed platform of NIH Alumni Association. I am Dr. Shumon Haldar, 13 batch BHMS and 12 batch MD from the National Institute of Homeopathy. And I consider myself as a homeopreneur, that is homeopathic entrepreneur. My passion for using internet as a tool to enhance my every aspect of homeopathic journey have helped me a lot in my life, in my homeopathic career. And it is a small endeavor to giving back to the homeopathic fraternity, to my mother institution, that helped me to grow up and become what I am today. So without any further ado, let us start. Let us share my screen. And Orko, please keep Dr. Ashish Pashu along with me.
Yes, I am here,
Shubham.
You didn't open from the entire screen option. Now it's okay. Yes.
It's okay now? Yeah.
Yes.
So today's topic is strategic use of IT or information technology for homeopaths. We all know that our profession is a noble profession, because we do so much good for the society. Yet there is a big issue. Most of us are not paid enough as compared to the value we add to the society. As a homeopathic doctor and being an ethical healthcare professional, we want to serve thousands of people. We want to have our own clinic where patients will be queued up every day. And some of us also wants to have our own hospitals or care homes. Also, we want to get name, fame, respect, wealth. But the main problem is we don't know how to do that. We are not aware of it, how to achieve that. Because we are not a marketer, we are not a businessman, but don't worry. At the end of this webinar, I'm sure those who are budding homeopaths or those who have already established themselves as an efficient prescriber or a good homeopath in their own circle, everybody will be able to get something from this webinar. And I would also like to have this webinar as an interactive one. And I would request our moderator, Dr. Ashish Basu, to keep me engaged, to keep our audience engaged with some questions so that this session become an interactive one.
This is Ashish Basu.
First, we need to understand what is digital mindset. We are all a good prescriber. I know that everyone who is listening here are very good prescriber, very good homeopaths. But whenever it comes to something digital in mind, especially before this COVID-19 era, COVID-19 time, I used to listen to everyone that we don't need to go to social media. We don't need to go to any other websites. We don't need to go to any other way. Whatever practice we are doing in our own field, that is enough. But the time, my friend, time has changed. Because whatever I have seen, in every 5 years, the pattern of practice changes. And maybe it is very trivial at first, but if we don't get those signs and symptoms of change, later on we find ourselves that we are not being able to cope up with the changes with time. So today I am going to tell you if we are ready for the change. Changes are difficult. I know changes are difficult. Coping with changes is also very difficult. So whenever it is changing, supposing during this COVID-19 period, everyone was going to online clinic, and most of us found it very difficult to these changing times. So we will have to have our open mind to embrace the change and flourish thereafter. So it is the digital mindset that is very much important. So during this changing time also, we have found that patient mindset has also changed. We need to be aware of this. Why patient mindset has changed? Because no patients come to a doctor nowadays without researching anything on that topic or something about doctors. So there is real deviation in patient mindset. If we don't catch up with it, it is very difficult for us to practice in a better way. We need to change first, then we need to understand the changing mindset of the patients. That is what I'm talking about here. This is the clutter and declutter. Cluttering our mind means so many noise and signals are there that we are not being able to focus what is actually needed in that particular stage of my practice or in my homeopathic career. So it is time to declutter those noises and to focus on what is really important so that we can practice our pathy in a better way. We can make a personal brand in a better way, and we can serve many people in a very consistent way and propagate the popularity of homeopathy. And also, we can meet the patient's expectation. Why I am telling you all these things? Because information technology or internet is a tool by which all these things can be changed, enhanced for the better. And if we do our basics right, then only we will be able to use this tool in its full form. And that will be actually the paradigm shift in our career, in our practice, whatever you say. So let us understand the present scenario. You see, with the advent of Jio, internet penetration is much more than ever before. because nowadays I'm sure it is more than 2 billion plus people are using internet on their handset all over the world. So it is the right time to make ourselves oriented to the digital culture. And already I have told you that the consumer behavior has also changed. This evolution of consumer behavior has both positive and negative aspects, because everybody comes, they are told that they are Google doctor. Okay. So whenever they come to us, they ask so many things. If you are not aware of those things, then it will be a very difficult situation for everyone, for both patient party and the doctor's part. So we need to change ourselves accordingly. And there are rise of digital channels. Orco has already made one for us. So this is a kind of digital channel like YouTube, Facebook, Instagram. These are the digital channels. These digital channels has opened up new era for personal branding for doctors, because doctors generally do not advertise themselves. It is not ethical and also maybe perhaps not legal, but they can build their own brand. So these kind of digital channels are of much importance today for building doctors' personal brand. Doctors, actually, I have seen many great homeopaths. They know this strategy. Maybe we don't know, but they know the strategy, how to build a personal brand. So believe me, this is a high time where you can build your personal brand very easily. So let us start today. And also there is growing demand for next generation healthcare applications. In case of us, we have different repertorization softwares, clinic management softwares, in case of hospitals, ERP softwares, enterprise resource planning softwares. These are the things. There are so many things to say regarding IT strategy, but today I will focus my attention only to this personal branding aspect of the homeopaths, and also how we can make our practice better with the use of information technology. Dr. Basu, do you have any questions regarding this, so that we can make it an interactive one?
Yes, Suman, I'm still hearing. I want some more clarifications regarding those use of how the young homeopaths or people like us can use these digital channels as their personal development of their personal brand. How can it be used? How you should go for the for these things easily and readily? Because all are not equally acquainted with the IT sector, so it must be easily done. So that, how can it be done for us? That I need an explanation.
Okay. So you see, thank you for the question, and I think this is a very good point from which we can start our discussion and going deeper. Like whenever we start our practice, we have lot of things in our mind, where to open up a new clinic. I don't know the market research, whether homeopathy is popular there or not, whether how many homeopathic doctors are there, whether people will accept me as a doctor there. These are the questions coming to mind for a budding homeopath. But we need to understand from the patient's point of view also, how patients are interacting with doctors, healthcare professionals, to nursing homes, to hospitals, how they are interacting with. You see, this is the graph which tells that 35% people are preferring online patient portal before for booking their appointment or for researching about the doctor or the organization. And also they are responding to phone calls, emails, mobile apps and text messaging. These are the most important is online patient portal. So we need to have our own website for that. Okay. I'll go into that matter a little bit later on. So, what patients want? At first, we need to understand that. What patients want? Patients want personalized care alert, guided healthcare, patient education, healthcare provider availability, and health records. These are the wants of patient. If we understand this each point, then we will be able to have one particular, or we will be able to choose what are the content management system, what are the customer relationship management system, what are the patient management systems we need to take in place, so that we will be able to cater the patient's need in a better way. So what about this personalized care alert? Suppose I have written down, please visit 15 days after this treatment. So, but patient generally forgets. So if there is alert system in place, after 15 days, patients will be alerted that you need to talk to your doctor or you need to visit to the clinic for second time or third time. Okay. This is the first aspect. This is the patient experience part. Before that, we need to educate our patients something. You can search for anything. Suppose if we go into an interactive way, let me open. Is it visible? Harko, is it visible?
Much clear.
Visible, no?
The size of the screen is...
The screen is paused for some reason. You can type.
Okay. So, keep me interactive, okay? Just tell me something so that
Shumon, we can make it...
Pardon?
Shumon, hear me. Whatever you write here on the screen, you also share in your voice also, because all the whatever written on the screen are not readable properly. The sizes are small. So you tell in voice also.
Okay. Of course. Thank you. Maybe due to internet connectivity issue, but here it is showing my internet connection is strong enough. I don't know why it is showing.
It's not because of internet connectivity, but it is due to the StreamYard process. So that's why.
Yeah, right.
Okay. Anyway, I'm not using that. Yeah. So we need to understand the interaction point, touch point. These are the touch points where we can enhance our patient's experience. Where number one is appointment booking or cancellation.
Sorry to interrupt in between. Please make sure to click on the hide option and also turn on the slideshow option. Yes, thank you.
Okay. So you understand that the first touch point is appointment booking option. We can easily adopt this by using Calendly. I am going to show you. This is the software we use generally. Just let me see. I'll be showing you all the free tools that you can use for enhancing your practice online. This is the Calendly, where you can just sign it up with your email ID and it will present you with an interface higher you will be able to, the higher your patients will be able to book your appointment and also cancel up your appointment. They also will be able to get timely notifications before and after the appointment. So it is a very great tool. You can use it for free, and for the enhanced interaction, you can pay a little bit of fees.
Shumon, this yes. this software, as you are telling, is free, and how can we yeah. get that? Where from the people will be able to get it? Please highlight.
Yeah, it is calendly.com. Okay, calendly.com. This is an online, it is software as a service. It is known as software as a service. You don't have to download anything. If you have your website online, then you can easily integrate it with your website. Okay.
If a person is not having website, if a person is not having yeah. website,
the link will be provided in description.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Of course, I will be providing. The thing is that if you are not having a website, I will come to the portion later on. We are here to enhance our experience, patient's experience. Okay. So if we want to enhance that patient's experience, having just a moment, having an website is going to be a must in this post-COVID era. That you don't have to be very expensive one, but if you have one, then and if you are in private practice, then it is going to be a boon for you, because you will have the all the power to engage with your patient base, to educate them and to follow them up. For you can remind them up with this simple softwares like Calendly. If you don't have, then also you can, if you don't have a website, then also you can use Calendly. But having a website is always have its own benefits, okay? Then after your patients, after you have seen your patient, how you will be able to interact with patients for follow-up, or for if he has any complaints, or most of the most importantly, you need to collect some testimonials from them. That will also build your personal branding, and you will be able to grow as a good physician in that way. Okay. So patient experience matters. These are the ways. Website is one of the ways you can interact with patients, but these are the ways like fax, telephony, mail, chat, social media, conferencing, voicemail, mobile. These are the ways you can interact with your patients. If there is universal unified system, then it is always better. There are some systems I will talk to that later on, like this. Suppose you have one CRM or patient management system where every patient may get SMS, email, push notification or WhatsApp notification, or they have the facility to call on any of your representative, or so, and every information will be locked on back in the back end, so that you will be able to do it in a better way. Suppose you think, suppose you are taking a logbook where patients, 6 months ago there was a patient that had some serious issue. After that, you gave your prescription, and after that he never consulted you. You have forgotten. It will not be a time saving matter if you have a digital case record and digital appointment system where just you type before 6 months and it will be showing all the patient's record of the last 6 months, how he has been interacted with, what are the complaints he has told to you or to your representative. So if all the patient's record in a unified way, you will be able to get in one place. Okay. This is the thing what I was telling you, Dr. Basu, regarding investment in modern responsive website. Most of us are net savvy nowadays, because and we are all using our handset or mobile devices. If your website is responsive, then they will be very easily give a review of your treatment through that website only. So you will be able to collect all the reviews or patient testimonials, and that will eventually help other patients to know more about you, to more, and you will have the chance to serve them better. Do you have any question regarding this?
Yeah. The question is that what is the actual investment to be done, and how cheaper can it be done? Because the newcomers, especially the beginners, they won't have sufficient amount to start up with a good amount for the website. They are getting a clinic, investing in the medicines. So apart from all these, setting up a website that will be a the monetary part involved is also important. Please enlighten on what is the minimum investment can be done.
Minimum investment is zero. Okay, suppose you can have your free website on Wix.com, Wix.com, okay, Wix.com. But if you want to have a professional experience for your patients, then you need to spend some amount of money. That depends on the level you are going to get into. Suppose I can say minimum you can expect 5K to 15K. Okay, it depends on the back end. It is for means you don't have to renew it for every year, just minimum 2000 or 3000 rupees per year for the domain and space you need to spend. Otherwise, for development purposes, that will be a one-time cost. Okay, so you can contact with a good developer of your area who has experience in developing medical websites, and he will be able to help you. But here we are not for having just an website. We need to understand why a website ranks, why whatever you are writing or whatever you are presenting on that website, whether patients are able to see that or not. For that, it comes to responsiveness, number one, comes to SEO optimization, search engine optimization. Okay, if suppose someone is, I'm not sure whether my internet connectivity is permitting or not, because it is going very slow. Suppose here I write treatment for fibromyalgia, suppose. Myalgia in homeopathy. In Kolkata, suppose. You see, first three results are P. Banerjee and Dr. Batras. Can you see the screen? Are you able to see the screen?
Yes.
Yes, Shuman.
Okay. You see, they have invested a lot on this. You see, Dr. Shunimal Sarkar, Dr. Batra, Jilakso, Dr. Batra, so many times. This is known as local listing. Okay. These are the things you can do it freely. But you need to understand that you should have to do this, and you can ask your developer or website designer that your listing should be in such a way that it can rank. You can have free listing on Practo, you can have free listing on JustDial, you can have free listing on Libret. Initially, you don't have to invest too much for having your online presence, but you need to do it because this will create so many backlinks to your own websites, and your own website will be a valuable one in the long run. Okay. Third way is having engaged in content marketing. What is content marketing? Content marketing helps to forge strong relationship with patients, staff, community, and prospective employees, and delivers thought leadership, which enhances credibility. Credibility is the thing that we doctors want. And this content marketing, suppose you have written a piece on fibromyalgia, and somebody will cite from that. Somebody, whenever they are searching on Google, they may, if it is highly relevant, if it is highly authentic, and if it is SEO optimized, then it will show in the first page of Google, and thereby you will also gain credibility as the writer of that content. And you can also divert your patients from that article to your own clinic or to your own practice, whatever website you are having. Okay. So content marketing is a great way to enhance your practice. Then another thing is, you should be knowing what type of content a healthcare provider or as a homeopath you should publish. You can publish educational content. You can publish educational content is very important because I have seen that around 94,000 searches on piled statement with homeopathy in Kolkata in a year. You understand the sheer number of volume of search content. So if you have a good content on treatment of piles with homeopathy on your website or any other website which have a backlink on your website, then how much valuable your content will be, and how many patients you have a chance to get. Another thing is inspirational content. You can write inspirational content like your success stories. Our last presenter, previous presenter, Dr. Swant Ranjan has said, these are all inspirational case studies. He can publish it on his website, own website, so that people will come there, go there, and they will see, oh, these are the things that can be achieved through homeopathic practice. So these are the kinds of inspirational content. You can harness hashtags on social media also, because hashtags are the tags. Suppose you are using hashtag of piles treatment with homeopathy, hash piles treatment homeopathy in Kolkata, in Patna. So these are the hashtags that help search engines on social media and also on Google to categorize that piece of content as a relevant one. Okay. And you can also use user generated content. Suppose people are commenting on your websites regarding your content, and that comments can also be used as the content of any article. Okay. You can use your brand awareness on social media. You can establish your profile in a very good way on major social networks. You can decide which social network you will spend the most time on. You can consider social advertising also. Most important thing is consistency. Whenever you are publishing something on social media, that may be educational type, that may be inspirational type, that may be engaging type, but consistency is must. You should have to have a calendar where you can schedule all the contents in 1 month in advance, and there should be a brand consistency also. The color, the font, the logo that you use in social media, that should be consistent enough so that your brand message should have a good message, consistent message to your prospective patients. Okay, you can connect with people, suppose through Twitter, anybody can connect with anybody instantly. Okay, so instant connection is now possible with doctors or doctor's team very easily. And you can track your key performance metrics, key performance indicators, like how many people are engaging on social media with your post, how many people are staying on your website for how long, whether they are commenting there or not, from your website, where they are going. These are all key performance indicators of using information technology and having a good result thereafter. You can, this is the lead management, means whenever the prospective patients are coming to your website, whether you are able to understand their behavior, whether they are giving you their phone number or their email ID so that you can engage them later on, whether they are one time they are coming and going, what was their intent, was their intent just for searching information, or was their intent was to get a treatment done from you, that you will have to differentiate and understand. Dr. Basu, whatever I was telling, no, the generally whatever you see on websites, that is the front end of the website, and the back end matters. On front end, a people who is searching on Google and coming to the website, if we don't have a system in place where we will be actively interact with them, whether we will be able to understand who the person is who is coming from Google or any search media or social media, then we will have no use of having a website. Suppose a people who is searching for getting acute piles treatment done, and we don't understand the intent, means he needs treatment, and on our website we don't have any system in place so that the person gets an interaction automatically, and somehow the back end people will get alerted, yeah, these people has come for an intention of having a consultation with the doctor, and he needs some amount of understanding how the process will be, what the process will be. So on the back end, in the back end, if yes, there is yes. In the back end, if no place, no system in place, so that we understand how the patient journey will be on our site, then there is no use of having any website. On free websites, this is not possible. Okay, but if we understand that this is the minimum amount of investment we will have to make, so that in the long run we will be able to flourish our business. Suppose so much amount of money we are investing on our physical clinic, okay, and if we invest some amount of money on our online clinic also, which will be open for 24 hours, people may visit that anytime, and if there is one system in place, so that using artificial intelligence, the patient will get interacted, and the that chatbot will be able to get the phone number and the email ID of that patient, so that we will be able to interact later on. Means human interaction will be happening later on. Okay, will not that be great? What do you say? Dr. Bashu, are you there? Hello.
And more you improve the website, more interactive it will be with the patients. But people should go step by step, starting from the basics. Then as you get into it, as you get acquainted with the whole matter, as you get acquainted with the whole subject, we can increase it according to our needs and according to the potentialities of the website. And yeah, your presentation is extremely well. Just enlighten that how we can further improve, use this in our day-to-day practice.
Pardon? I could not hear. How
we can just enlighten on this point, that how we can further use this, as you are telling, the development of websites, starting from the basics, how we can further use this in our day-to-day practice.
Yeah, day-to-day practice is important here because number one is, just a moment. Yes, in day-to-day practice, here you see this picture. We can have a system. It is very easy. We can have a system. Suppose on WhatsApp, we can have a system where a patient will be alerted on WhatsApp that he has an appointment. And whenever the patient is coming to the coming to the doctor, and the treatment is over. For that particular consultation, he has been prescribed, suppose, 3 or 4 medicines. And there is system in place, we can use that. He will be alerted every day when to take medicines. It is very easy. Just contact me later on. I don't want to go to that referral portion of this thing, but I can help you with that. You can just email me and I'll be helping. It will be my pleasure to help you with the softwares or any other systems you need. And suppose he will be getting push notifications on his mobile. He will be getting one SMS. These are the ways we can enhance our practice. And another thing, we can use a few softwares for repertorization purposes. What Dr. Bashu was telling initially, we can use our repertorization softwares like Radar. Radar has inbuilt patient management system also. Nowadays, Homepath is also having patient management system inbuilt. So that, But the thing is that patient management systems are all locally. You cannot use, suppose you are having 2 or 3 clinics. Some of us have our target, no? We should be practicing in 2-3 clinics, or the clinic will be run on automation. Some amount of automation will be there so that we will be able to manage all the clinics from one place. Okay. For that reason, we need to have this kind of information systems strategy in place so that all the systems will be unified. From anywhere, we will be able to see all the clinics activities, all the active financial activities, and all the patient lead generation activities from one place. That is the thing we should be striving for in future. And Dr. Bashu, I think that is sufficient.
Suman, one thing I also want to ask you, that how can this be used, these softwares be used or the websites be used, if a patient is, for example, I'm in a leave. Say, for example, it's Sunday, I'm not having clinic. A patient is having a trouble. Yeah. Patient calling you. But you need to have the history of the patient, what medicines you have given to the patients. And then only you can suggest the patient that, yes, I have given you Cefalinum 1M last time. Now you, the patient, I according to me, the patient should take placebo or any acute medicines. But I must see the case history. I must go through the case history which I have recorded in the clinic. How can this be developed that I can see the case history immediately, instantly, and can...
And can very good question, Professor. Very good question. It is very good question. It is the question of the time because it is very important because we are all mobile. So we need to have one effective mobile strategy for our clinic. Okay. Whatever softwares we are having right now, repertorization softwares, they are all statics, means you can have your information database in one place, that is in one clinic. It may be on one device or two or three devices, but all these are static information there. You cannot have your information uploaded to any cloud-based software. So that wherever you are, you can access it through any of the devices you wish. So you need to have proper mobile strategy. Just let me show you. This is the mobile strategy I am talking about. If you software as a service, clinical management systems have come up like QAP, okay? Where if you use that, you will be able to manage all the patient's data, prescription data, visit data in one place through a mobile app or through a mobile optimized website. So I think that answers your question. And if it is possible, right now it is possible. And I have seen many people are using, not in Kolkata, but in Maharashtra and also in UP.
Shumon, there is one question from me that this a person starts a clinic and starts using this. Say from patient number one, I am using this software database so that the patient I can revert back to the patients whenever they need. But for some physicians like us, who have started practicing along 20 or 30 years back, we are having a huge patient database. Now, if I start this from today only or from tomorrow, how can we incorporate that total database into this system? Is it possible? Or this is a very clumsy matter, it will take time, whatever.
Just clumsy. Thank you. It is also a very good question. You see, these are all practical questions and there are strategies in place for this. This is known as patient record management system. Okay. And the previous patient records, if you want to incorporate with the system, what you have, which you have started using right now, is very easily done by many agencies. Just you will have to ask them to digitize your content and they will be digitizing all your previous patient's content with compliance because they will not leak your patient's information to anywhere else. And they will just digitize and make ready for your clinic that data so that you will be able to harness the power of data using those kind of patient management system which are on SaaS platform, means software as a service platform. That software you will not be able to buy, but you will be able to use that for an indefinite period for certain amount of fees, recurring fees, monthly or annually, and they will also help you with digitization of the data through some agencies or vendors. Okay, so you don't have to bother about it because I have seen a few eminent homeopaths have already done that in various part of the country by using vendors, by using their huge amount of patients' data and digitizing that and uploading it to the cloud service so that for their entire team, that data will be visible as per the access control system. Dr. Basu, yes, is there any question?
Yes. You can continue.
It's okay. These are the things actually I'm open for the question and answer. If there is any question and answer from the
There is a question from Dr. Gautam Ghosh.
Yeah, and also this is confidential,
obviously.
Yeah. Also, this is the my contact number and mobile ID. If there is any question from the medical fraternity that I am in homeopathy, I'll be really happy to help them for going digital, because this is the demand of time. Just go digital and enjoy the power of information technology in your practice. It will not replace you. It will enhance your practice. Many more patients you will be able to cater every day. If you go through it, you will be able to have multiple clinics simultaneously run by power of various softwares, and ultimately you will be able to manage a good practice, build a good reputation. And I'm sure that by using this tool and having an effective information technology strategy, homeopathy will flourish further for the next time to come. Thank you. Thank you very much.
The question that has been asked by Dr. Gautam Ghosh, I think it is very pertinent, but this is also true that I think so that any testimonials of the patients given to the doctors, if we are preserving those in the cloud, they are definitely to be personalized and to be protected personally. So there is no fear, I think, that the confidentiality of the contents will be published publicly. I think there is no fear in that context that the confidential documents will be passed on publicly. I think there is no such issue.
Yeah, rightly said. Actually, patients are interacting on social media also nowadays, and you can see so many reviews of doctors on social media. And they are publishing it on social media, that is open for all. You don't need to worry about it. And that's why it comes to reputation management. This is also a very pertinent theme for the modern times, because many hospitals or caregiving organizations or clinics or doctors themselves, they nowadays care about their reputation on social media, and some agencies are doing good job to understand the meaning, intent, or the context of a statement, or they try to understand the automatically, means with using robots, they try to understand what is the intent of that bhashan that patient or the patient party has written down on any other websites. From that, they will be able to generate whether this is positive for the doctor or the clinic, or negative for the doctor or the clinic. And on that note, they will be able to reply on that social media or that website that it is okay, that we have not been able to cater with much care, but if you come here in future in our clinic, that we will be able to do justice whatever you have asked for. Okay, that way patient reputation management is being done by using the artificial intelligence softwares and using robots which crawl around websites and understand the intent of the content that is stated there.
Thank you so much. It was really very informative.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir.
That's a awesome session from Suman, and it's a very pertinent time-bound session. I'll first request Kalyani sir, please say something about today's two speakers and the CME.
Regarding Dr. Sant Ranjan, I'm really very happy, because all along, since few years, I'm inspiring alumni and present students of NIH to be prepared with the things presented by Sant Ranjan. Cure the cases, keep recordings,
either audio, visual, or through any way, and try to publish or to send to medias by which other homeopaths will be inspired by seeing that things are getting cured in homeopathic system and in proper Hahnemannian way. Many, many thanks, Sushant. And I am telling all the alumni, please follow his path. What is my experience by few years, by working with many allopathic stalwarts of the country in mother and child healthcare for few years with 23 states of India, that allopath doctors, those we are thinking that they are against homeopathy, it is very, very wrong. They are waiting for additional support for clinical or any other therapeutic system. What they want exactly, that you cure the cases certified by us or certified by the specialist, as it was shown through reports or videos or audios, that you have truly cured the cases. Go on increasing the number with documents, reports present before the people's. Automatically, the craze for homeopathy will increase. Government and all other supports will automatically be available. So everyone should be practice, with the practice, everyone should develop the practice of keeping documents, even in slightest thing. Say, for example, a fever. Keep a blood report. You see the total count, differential count. If you can show the neutrophil counts is coming down after getting recovery from the fever, that is one presented features that your Bryonia belladonna can reduce neutrophil counts. Anything, diarrhea, then your any trouble, get tested. And nowadays, patient will be very happy if you advise different investigation. Patient will think that doctor is knowledgeable person, doctor is caring, doctor knows many things. So he will immediately do the reports. And you will be surprised to know, I think you will support me, that nowadays patients are ready to pay any amount to the laboratory for investigation than that of fees to doctors. So please try to avail the chance that get tests, keep it documents before, during and after treatment. Only this is the thing which will improve homeopathy in a very fast way, and that will increase our confidence too. Now, regarding Suman Haldar, it is a very new chapter and very nice thing we have to cope with. Even you have seen that Hahnemann himself, by his different editions of Orbanum, he tried to adapt himself according to the clinical situations, according to the patients, according to the changing circumstances of the patients. So this changeability and adjustability should be with all of us. The more world is advancing, we have to advance accordingly. I told you that if Hahnemann could have been still alive, we could have been got more than 66 editions, I think. That means growing, developing in every aspect. So all of us must try to improve through this software system to upgrade us, to improve homeopathy, and to improve ourselves and to improve our confidence that we are not backward. We are not ancient type of doctors. So many, many thanks. Today's seminar is a new thing. We have got the internet facilities, software system, whatever is available, and day by day, the things will improve. Accordingly, we have to adjust ourselves. Thank you very much to Ranjan and Suman. Many, many thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And I'll request before our moderator sum up the session, I'll request Dr. Pralay Sharma to be on the screen. And he is going after a very important mission. That's about the Benevolent Fund. And Pralay is a major support and backbone behind all the CMEs we had been going through. Over to you, Pralay.
Thank you, Dr. Vidhu Mukherjee. Good evening to all of you. Good evening, Kalani sir. And in fact, it was a wonderful experience today to be in this webinar. That Dr. Shantaranjan is a very hardworking boy, in fact, of our institution. And we have seen him during the BHMS as well as while doing this MD course. Is very hardworking. And the presentation, what he has presented right now today in this webinar was been very excellent one and a very informative one. I'm not going to talk about that. What I want to talk is that the government of India has also made a portal for success case stories. Any one of us can put their experience into this portal. In this AYUSH system of portal, of course, we the homeopathy also been included into that. If you wish, I can give the link in the Alumni Association WhatsApp group, and that will be beneficial for all of them. And Shuman is our IT person. What I have seen for last 15 years around. Wallace, he has been very active in the IT sector, and he is not only active in the IT sector, he is a good clinician. And we are very proud of Dr. Shantaranjan as well as for Dr. Shuman. And Ash has been always good in moderating, and has a long time experience we do have with him. And Pragya is always good in her speech too. What for I'm being called here right now today is that the regarding the benevolent fund, and as you all know, we are for a couple of months we are generating a benevolent fund for the Alumni Association, and NIH Alumni Association benevolent fund is it provides support to alumni in times of unusual need. And this is generated and supported by the ex-students. This is basically a financial assistance to alumni in their prolonged illness or in case of death to their family member. We provide this help. And what I would like to say is that by this time, we have from our institution, we do have ex-DPNS students. We have a BHMS students. And we have also have the MD students. If I am not wrong, that it is almost 2,600 number of alumni we do have in our approximately we do have in the name of NIH Alumni Association. The member should be like that. But unfortunately, we in the WhatsApp group and also in the Telegram group, we do have a few numbers. A few numbers of participants into this alumni group, and this is the right time that we should ask all the alumni to be in the same platform, and that platform could be the Telegram group. By this webinar, who are watching this webinar right now or will be watching this with this video in the YouTube. I do have a strong appeal to all of them that to be very generous to donate for the benevolent fund and to be in the Telegram group. And I assure and I'm sure that this whatever amount is generated for the benevolent fund, it not been used for other purposes other than the help towards the alumni in their need, in their unusual need. Not regularly we do provide in times when they need unusually they need financial assistance. We are helping them. We have started helping them to the family members of the alumni. With this earnest request that whatever amount it can be, it may not be in 10,000, it may not be in 5,000. It can be in 500. It can be in 300 in rupees. If you donate to generate more fund for the benevolent fund, the Alumni Association will do a wonder towards the family members of the alumni group. With this request, once again, thank you so much. Thank you for listening me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pralay. Thank you for your appeal and being present for so long and encouraging us to go ahead with the CME. I'll request our moderator today, Dr. Ashish Basu, to do his concluding part, to take the question answers for both the speakers, and request for all the participants who had been watching this that you can have a participation certificate, digital participation certificate, which had been pro forma had been shared across both the all the three WhatsApp groups. You have to the link given below in the description of the YouTube, and you will get your digital certificate, digitalized certificate directly in your email. Over to you, Dr. Ashish.
Yes, thank you, Mitunda. Thank you, Dr. Kulani, sir. We are at the close of today's session. It was, as I told previously, it was a very interesting and very informative session to be, both from Dr. Sawant Ranjan and from Dr. Shimon Handal. Dr. Ranjan has very elaborately and very very finely stated about 10 cases of his clinics, the starting from the use of staphylococcin as a block remover, then using lycopodium in a case of bloated abdomen, then with the, then a case of increased creatinine where he used thuja, and then in the case of myocardial infarction where he used thyroidine followed by benzoic acid and followed by Vipera, and then a case of heart failure, and etc. I'm not telling all the 10 cases, but all the cases were excellent. Dr. Sawant Ranjan, I really thank you from the part of all the members of the NIH Alumni Association and all the members of the fraternity of homeopathy. Only one question I do have for you, if you have kind, if you can kindly answer, that in the fourth case, where it is a case of MI, you had used thyroidinum 1M followed by benzoic acid and followed by Vipera. What is the potency of benzoic acid used in that that particular case? Yes, Dr. Ranjan, you please unmute yourself. Please unmute yourself.
Benzoic acid 200.
And that you told that 5 drops thrice daily. Can you please explain the dose? Can you please explain the dose? Why 5 drops of 200?
Patient was in very severe pain. And actually, one drop, our literature says, but I had given.
Okay, you got the result. Okay.
We are part
and other cases were really, the other cases were really wonderful. And obviously, the case of deaf mutism and also that case of vocal cord paralysis where we can see the patient having food but not having cough. All the cases were really, really, really fabulous. We really thank you for presenting such wonderful cases to us. Thank you, Dr. Ranjan. And Shumon, as yes. And Shumon, all your cases, it had been an introductory session actually with you. So I don't need to sum up because we have already summed up. And really thank you for giving us a light, a path, how we can modernize ourselves, how we can fit ourselves to this present scenario, especially in this pandemic situation where the doctors are going online in most of the cases, in the most of the clinics. And in that cases, how we can mobilize our clinics in a definite way, in a definite category. We are really thankful to you and we shall be looking forward also so for your help to all the participants so that make them mobile and make them more acquainted with this system of practice in the days to come. Thank you, Dr. Haldar. And from the part of all the from all the participants of this NIH Alumni Association, and I again thank all both the speakers. I thank the hosts, Dr. Bidul Mukherjee and our respected sir, Dr. D.N. Kolyani, for giving us this opportunity to share our knowledge, share our experiences with the participants of the association. And the association gets enlightened with the contents shared with the speakers. Thank you to all of you. And with this, and also thank to Dr. Pragya Paramita for hosting, for starting the session. It was a nice presentation. Thank you. Thanks to all of you.
Thank you.
And by here, I close and hand over the session to Dr. Mukherjee and Dr. Pulley.
Sandranjan, want to say something, I think.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes.
Actually, last part of my slide probably ignored. In the last, I had a proposal for research in homeopathy. The first was to measurement of size of nanoparticle in its dilution. And second, the compare of the conventional medicine along with the nanoparticle prepared medicine clinically. So, I think
has been answered by Dr. Mukherjee.
No, I want to add something more. Listen, yes, I had one research work with cultivation of science in Jadavpur with the help of your different professor here at the department, including St. Xavier's College, Professor Puri, Father Abello. And in an effort of about few months in cultivation of science with so many scientists, the conclusion was this, that the things what you are claiming for nanoparticles and other things are the job of physics, nanophysics. That is not the duty of homeopaths to bring it out. So what was their reply after a few months of study? That doctor, you don't worry, that is our responsibility, is our job. But we will not be interested until and unless the countrymen, the whole Indian population or the government or majority of the people claim for this. So the way is, as a homeopath, you go on curing cases, go on showing the cured cases to populations, doctors, scientists, government, everywhere. Automatically the craze will increase. Automatically the responsibility on us will come. We will start working on the things what we want for, how alcohol molecules are carrying properties of materials. That is our job, not yours. You please don't waste time. So that was a brilliant stroke for me. I left all this type of searching and I concentrated all along on researches, how the cases can be cured. So that's why again I'm giving that the, what you are claiming for, we can proceed. But it is not our job. We are not that much competent to find out nanoparticles and this and that things, including electromagnetic fields, molecular waving, your spectrum differentiation, different institutions, including Bhabha Atomic Research Institute in Bombay, Bengal Engineering College in Shibpur, Jadavpur Cultivation of Science, different universities, IITs, they are trying their level best to find out how the alcohol molecules are carrying properties of matters. So we'll be eagerly waiting for that. But our main job is not to concentrate on those things for which we are not competent enough. We are not that much competent in physics and finer physics. So the thing we should concentrate more on curing cases, showing homeopathic success. Automatically the case will come and they will start working on what we are searching for. So definitely we'll keep it in mind. And you know that things have already been done. In NIH also, Bhabha Atomic Institute, Bombay, they came in NIH. I do not know whether you are there or not. They showed that potency 6 to 30, graphical changes are coming. In their seminar hall, they presented many cases. With the students, they showed there are changes. But how the changes are getting, it was difficult. And that seminar was presided by the Health Minister of West Bengal, who was Vice President of the governing body. He was highly emphasized by seeing the activities of Bombay Bhabha Atomic Research Institute. So these works are hiddenly going on. Scientists are already interested. We should not be worried about. So anyway, thank you for focusing the things. And I will request Prolay, especially, if you please kindly send the portal you asked for, that to send cured cases to government. Please send the portal in with our the network.
Yes, sir. It has come into action for last 7 days only. Anyone can join into this success stories in homeopathy. In fact, the Ayush system of medicine.
Okay.
and that will be kept in the Ayush Ministry, in the ministry for the references. And sir, so regarding the research, that what, sir, regarding the research of Dr. Shant Ranjan, I can comment a few words that it is more of the physics, and less of this homeopathy. As a homeopath, we can contribute. But if Dr. Shant Ranjan is interested, what I can suggest is that recently I do have a very good rapport to the IIT Kharagpur, and they are very interested. They are in fact interested in such kind of research. And if he can volunteer, he can come and we can introduce him. There will be no problem, no issue at all. Personally, one can go, and if he can convince them to their ethical committee, to their board of governance, and to the committee assigned for the research, if we can make them understand, then there is this process can be easily done with the financial help too. The government is always willing to give finance, but the work has to be genuine. So I'll request Dr. Shant Ranjan. You can keep touch with me, and I can make you introduce with the professor of IIT Kharagpur. And if he can come down to Kolkata and can go there and can make them convinced about that, it will be done. That I can assure. That those people are too much eager to help to upgrade the homeopathy impact. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Many, many thanks. Great information.
So, Vidyuddha, we shall conclude today's session. Yes, thank you, Orko. Thank you, Orko, for helping us.
Oh, welcome very much. So, let me just conclude this. Thanks for joining everyone who is on backstage right now and also present on screen. Thank you for joining. And to all those who are watching this live from their homes, sorry for the messy here because there is some problems with my fan. So if you want any type of if you want e-participation certificate, then you may check the form link which is given in description. Just your basic thing, you have to answer two questions. And first of all, you have to fill up the main things, main part on the first page. And on the second page, you may fill up, you have to answer the questions. And over there, you have to get one right, one answer right. And be careful while answering because many may have faced a problem with many questions and also missed out one. So please make sure to go through the question perfectly. And on the third page, there will be a checkbox, which you have to click it for compulsory in order to move out. And as soon as you complete your form filler process, it will be generated to your email as soon as it may take 30 seconds or it may delay for 30 seconds or it may delay for 5 to 15 seconds also. Depends on the internet and the server. So once again, thank you everyone for joining today's session. I hope you have enjoyed, and if you want more like this, there will be more like this. Please make sure to subscribe our channel and turn on the notification bell, which will be on the side, on the right side of the screen, and after subscribing. And for that, why you should press the notification bell? It is because to get updated on every live CME session we schedule, you will get the you will get update on that and get the notification as soon as we upload, as soon as we schedule. So again, do make sure to follow us on Instagram, Twitter, and do make sure to like our page on Facebook. All the links are given in description. And all the names are also given in description. And for the Calendly, the link is in description. You may check. I asked Suman sir, and Suman sir just provided me with the link. You can click over there. It's right in the description. And with this, thank you all for joining. And a very good night to everyone. Have a nice day ahead. Thank you.